Good morning. I did welcome to those who are joining us online, and thank you to everyone who labors each week to make that reality possible. And it's one of those things that's so easy to take for granted, but we're so glad to be able to offer that option to you. And so welcome if you're joining online, either live or if you're watching this video clip at a later time. It's nice to have you joining us. Welcome to each one gathered here in person. Does it seem like every year that the weather stays relatively cool and then all of a sudden it just surges forward? And yesterday we had a number of volunteers. We've been signed up for some time now to serve a meal up at Sojourner's Truth. Yesterday we did that up in Williamsport, and to some individuals and families who really appreciate that extra help and that support. And Pastor Chris did music and devotions, and Pam, thank you for organizing that on our behalf, and all the many people who stepped up. We had a number of volunteers up there yesterday, and I think, give or take a few, we were able to serve about 58 meals to those who were very blessed by that. And thank you to each one who helped to get the different menu items or to prepare the food, or volunteered and helped up there with us to be able to bless those who were present. And I know a few people prior to going up hearing the forecast were like, I wonder if they have air conditioning there. And they did not. And so we were grateful that we were serving a lunchtime meal and not a 6 or 7 o'clock at night meal, because it did get rather warm. So just by, we are a little handicapped here facility-wise, in the sense that to maintain the aesthetics of the sanctuary, we did not run ductwork up the sides or in the back or whatever. So to keep this cubic feet all the way up even to the balcony cool, the only air we have blows from the front. So when we get into these 90-degree days, we typically, now the air will shut off if it reaches a set temperature in here. But when we get the people in about an hour, the temperature in here goes up between 6 to 8 degrees. That's literally how quick it just goes right back up. So I know there are some of you that get cool very easily, okay? It's actually warmer in here in the winter than it is, in the summer, than it is in the winter, because these will shut off if we reach a certain temperature. But between the fans and the blowers, sometimes people get cool. And I know when we're in the South vacationing, my wife and daughter always have a jacket with when we go from outdoors into the air conditioning buildings. But if you know you're someone that gets cool easily, you may want to make sure you bring along a sweater, because I have to maintain the climate for the whole space. And there's other people that are sweating. So just be aware of that as we transition into the warmer temperatures. So there is youth tonight at 6. Just be mindful of that for those who will be impacted by that. Ken, thank you. Yesterday he made breakfast for us, the men, and led the devotional, and we thank him for that. We're hoping to do the next men's fellowship in August. We'll get you the dates for that and try to continue to engage as many of you as possible. So it was a busy day in ministry. And now this afternoon is the Muncie Baccalaureate service at the Church of the Resurrection at 2 p.m. So there'll be a worship service for the Muncie graduates today. And everyone is welcome to attend. I realize if you don't have someone you're connected to that's graduating, probably won't be there, but just I want to make sure that you're aware that service is happening today. And graduations, I was hearing that on the radio this week, in our area school districts will be taking place in the next 2 weeks. And so congratulations, and then the students will be off for the summer. Having said that, we mentioned previously that Awana does not run during the summer, but children's ministry continues, okay? So for the children, they will begin starting next week up here with us and then be released each Sunday during the summer months. And we still need teachers and helpers, so if you're interested in helping in that way, see Michelle. We also have to make sure we have a number of people we've got to update this year, clearances, and we have to keep them current for those that work with children and teens. So if you're not sure where you stand on that, just speak to Michelle, and she'll be glad to help to update you on that, okay? For those who've been praying for Terry Dickey, she went through her surgery well. Ed got a hold of me yesterday and said he was bringing her home. Yesterday, she has to go back in about a week or two for a few follow-up things, but she was headed home, so we thank the Lord. The doctors feel that went pretty well, And so thank you for your prayers for Terry. And it's good to be in the Lord's house this morning for our call to worship this morning. I knew our first worship song talked about how our Lord is higher than the mountains that we face. And so I had gone back into the Old Testament, into the Psalms, and this particular psalm wasn't in our hymnal. So I said, guys, can we just throw it on the overhead? You're welcome to follow along here from Psalm 18. The Lord thundered from heaven. I want you to just think about that for a moment. There's a chance we might have a thunderstorm this afternoon, I think is what they're saying. And when that's happening, maybe think of this passage. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded, for he shot his arrows and scattered the enemy with great bolts of lightning. He routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed, and the foundations of the earth laid bare at your rebuke, Lord, at the blast of breath from your nostrils. Wow. He reached down from on high, and he took a hold of me, and he drew me up out of the deep waters. You know that song, he brought me out of the miry clay, right? He set my feet on the rock. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place, and he rescued me, hear this, because he delighted in me. You know the Lord delights in you? He delights in you. And this first song reminds us one thing remains. In the midst of all the circumstances, the doubts, the difficulties that we sometimes have to overcome, one thing remains: God's love never, ever fails. If you're able, stand with us this morning as we go to the Lord in worship this day. And Lord, come and inhabit our praises, we pray, in your powerful name. Amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love, your love, your love.
And our hope is found in Christ alone, who never leaves us nor forsakes us, faithful to the grave, but he didn't remain there. Amen, Connie? Amen. Connie celebrating, one of her grandchildren got married this weekend. Yeah, got married yesterday. God love them, we were all smiling. They had an outdoor wedding. They chose to hold it in May so that it wouldn't be so hot. Just goes to show, right? The best laid plans, right? But I'm sure it was a beautiful wedding, so yep. So congratulations. In Christ alone, my hope is found.
Is my
I don't know why. I just, knowing we were going to do this song this morning, I kept coming back to this. It just seemed appropriate. So the next song's number 6. I shouldn't have taken my glass. 687 in your songbooks. If you want to follow along there, we'll also have it on the overhead for you. Standing on the promises of Christ my King. If he can come up out of the grave, friends, by the way, just like he said he would, can't you trust everything that he said? I mean, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later in the message. But standing on the promises of Christ, and notice in this day and age where we're obsessed with personal pronouns, my King. I trust he's your Lord and Savior this morning. Let's sing this song. I love that third verse when it said, standing in the liberty where Christ makes free, standing on the promises of God, perfect present cleansing in the blood for me, standing on the promises of God. In Christ alone, my hope is found. Well, the scripture this morning, as well as these songs, have led us to this prayer course, which reminds us that God can and will make a way. Just rejoicing, Seth had a road trip, and his trip was short in comparison, I guess, to the trip Anna's taking, which I guess then we could say is short in comparison to the trip that has already taken place for their niece. We've been praying for, now, this name always gets me, but Solomia, right, is her name? And sounds very, I don't know what, philosophical or biblical or something, yeah. Or it sounds like part of a song. Oh, Solomia. No, you don't want me to sing that. So we had five people just tuned out of the video right there. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. But she was able to get out of the nation of Ukraine. If you're watching online or if you're a guest this morning and you don't know Anna, she is from the nation of Ukraine. And still, her family is in the Ukraine. And her niece was able to get out of the country and made her way to France. And they recently came to know that the United States is allowing her niece to come into the U.S. And now it remains to be seen. Be praying with us that everything goes, that the Lord opens the necessary doors for her niece to be able to remain in the United States. But they are allowing her into the United States, and so Seth took Anna to the airport last night, I guess it was, to fly over to France to bring her niece back to the United States of America. You talk about how God can make a way. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? And so I don't know, you may even, hopefully you will get to see her. Hopefully she'll come along and make her way into church, and maybe we'll get to meet her. But pray for safe travels. For Anna and for her niece. You'll remember that name, won't you? Solomia, yes. Yeah, you'll never forget it.
Pastor.
I wonder what she'd think if we sang that when she first joined. No, not me. Anyway, yeah.
She's going to graduate from her high school Monday morning at 7 in the morning by Skype.
Oh, wow. Okay, graduating by Skype. Wow, there you go. So, actually her age... She's 17, creates one of the immigration problems because she's a minor, technically. And just kind of pray that the Lord's perfect will would be accomplished in that situation. But I think that there's a family nonetheless that's buying into this, the truth of this song, that God can make a way where there seems like, you know, this is impossible. Guess what? God specializes in the impossible. Amen? All right, so this is our prayer song. If you wish to come forward, you're welcome. If you wish to be anointed, just let me know, okay? And let's sing this together. that, say amen. I know you don't normally begin prayer with amen, but that's okay. The Lord understands. You're welcome to be seated. For those of you that knew Luther Nelson Sr., he pastored at our Williamsport church for a number of years. And so some of you that have a little bit more connectedness to the district may know, have known Luther. He went to his heavenly reward, I believe it was yesterday. I had to smile. A colleague in ministry reminded me with her words. She said, "I've never known anyone that was hopeful that there would be snow in heaven." And I thought, oh dear heavens, Luther, what are you getting us into? You all know I'm not a big winter person. And I guess Luther always hoped there'd be snow in heaven. So I don't know if the Lord's going to make that a reality for Luther or not. But, you know, I was talking with Bob Smith this morning, Steph, Nancy, Ruth, family members. We've been praying for Jonathan Fisk, right, Fisk? I have that right, Steph? Steph's brother-in-law, and they're looking into the possibility of a lung transplant for him. And I was just sitting here thinking of how these situations can look impossible, but God can make a way. And so let's continue to remember to pray for Jonathan. And once again, thank you to everyone who's been so active in ministry this weekend. And I just pray our service today is a blessing for the young people from Muncie High School. And I don't know the schedule of the other baccalaureates, but if someone wants to make me aware of those, I can try to pass those along as well. And but just praying that that service will be meaningful. Let's go before the Lord in prayer this morning. We're going to anoint Liz here. Father God, we're thankful that we can come to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit of God. We just ask, Lord, for a physical touch. We ask for emotional healing. Lord, we pray that you would be present in our relationships. Lord, we pray that you would be with our family members. Lord, we especially pray this day for those in our family that we're not able to gather with, even as we think of Connie being with family yesterday for this special occasion. And Lord, what a blessing that is. We pray your blessing on this new marriage, this new covenant relationship that was established yesterday, Lord. I just pray that your hand would be upon them in their relationship, Father God, and that you would bless the household they established together. Lord, I thank you for our children, for our teens. Lord, as they're finishing up the school year, for our college students, many of whom have made their way home at this juncture. Lord, I just pray your continued blessing and that your will would unfold before them. And Lord, as we remember those in that age range, we're mindful of Anna and this trip with her niece, Solomia, who is coming to the United States. And Lord, you have a plan and a purpose for her life. Lord, it's easy for us to project and to say, you know, this is how things should unfold. Lord, it's probably unlikely that most of us would have even suspected there would be an avenue that made possible her coming to the United States. But Lord, you have opened that door. And Lord, I just pray for safe travel for them. Lord, I just pray that your perfect will would be accomplished in her life and in the life of the entire family. Those who remain in the nation of Ukraine, and we can see on the news all that's occurring over there. Lord, maybe one of the things we should be grateful for this day is that we're not fearful while we're gathered here that a missile or a bomb or a tank or someone with automatic weapons or whatever is going to march onto the property. Not because they're specifically targeting Christians gathered at worship, but Lord, there are literally people that we've seen the images gathering in places where their own safety is in doubt as they gather to worship. Lord, would our heart be such that we would pray out to you and cry out to you if we knew there was an imminent physical threat? And yet, Lord, that brings to mind an interesting thought. How often in the times that we need you most, when we're literally desperate for you to work in a way that we can't see? The psalm this morning said, where our enemies have risen up against us and the path seems impossible. Lord, it's then that we need you. It's then that we need you to work. And Father, maybe one of the things we need to seek forgiveness for this morning, Lord, is trusting too much in ourselves and not turning over to you those things that you alone, as God, can address. Lord, we can't stop the wars of men. We can't change the hearts of men. of domestic leaders, never mind foreign leaders. But Lord, your word says you bring men and women up and you bring them back down. And so, Lord, we just pray that your perfect will would continue to unfold in our world. Lord, we just pray a blessing on each one. We've mentioned Terry Dickey, Lord. We have mentioned her health concerns. We've mentioned Jonathan Fisk, Lord. We have many in our own fellowship that have ongoing battles physically. We just pray continuing strength and health and wellness. We pray for those individuals, couples, families we ministered to yesterday up at Sojourner's Truth. Lord, that they would be well fed in their physical countenance, Lord, but more importantly, Lord, that they would come to know you personally. And Lord, that you would have an impact in their minds and in their hearts and in their lives. Lord, we just pray that you would lend a blessing to each one gathered here in this fellowship, those watching online. Lord, may your word go forth in power. Lord, meet each need abundantly. Father, help us to walk in the love and the grace and the joy you provide, as we sang about this morning, the freedom and the liberty that come in Jesus Christ. They are ours through what Christ has accomplished when he came out of that grave. And so we are co-heirs with Christ. Lord, thank you. We thank you for your faithfulness to us. We commit these cares and the many that are unspoken to you. And Lord, I ask now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. To you be honor, glory, and praise, now and forevermore. And all God's people said, amen and amen. May it be so. Friends, God is good and all the time. Amen and amen. Well, I asked Martha if she'd speak today, but she worked so hard yesterday up at Sojourner, she said she'd prefer if I did it. So I said, that's fair. That's fair. I'll do it. We don't do things very democratically around here, do we? No. Well, you know, I've been looking at these generational questions. These generational questions. And they tell us that each generation has a question that reaches to their heart or touches them specifically. Last week, we were looking at the baby boomers and their generational question, which is, what is true? Now, this one's kind of closely linked with a subtle shift. We're moving on to Generation X. Doesn't that sound? It sounds like a hot sci-fi movie or something, doesn't it? Generation X, X-Men, I don't know. Connie, I'm part of Generation X. Maybe I'm an X-Man. Yeah, right, that's cool. They never sent me the check for the movie. But anyway, we're moving on to Generation X. So let's just jump in today to Generation X's generational question, and that is, what is real? What is real? Lew Wallace, I don't know if you've heard of Lew Wallace, but Lew Wallace was the governor of New Mexico. And he was writing a book against Jesus Christ. But a strange thing happened as he went to write this treatise. He converted to Christianity. Reminds me of some others that have gone down that road, right? In seeking to disprove Christ, learned things they could not refute. And this is how he told a friend that it happened. Quote, I had always been an agnostic and denied Christianity, Wallace said. Robert C. Ingersoll, a famous agnostic, was one of my most intimate friends. And he once said to me, see here, Wallace, you are a learned man and an excellent thinker. Why don't you gather material and write a book to prove, now remember our foundational question today, what is real, to prove the falsity concerning Jesus Christ. Go ahead and write a treatise that proves that faith in Jesus Christ is false, that no such man ever lived, much less the author of the teachings found in the New Testament of the Bible. Such a book would make you famous. It would be a masterpiece in a way of putting to an end this foolishness about this so-called Christ. Wallace went home and told his wife about the project. Now, she was a member of the Methodist Church and did not like the idea whatsoever. But Wallace began to collect the necessary materials from libraries all over the world that covered the period in which Jesus Christ should have lived. He did that for several years and then began writing. He was four chapters into his book when it became clear to him that Jesus Christ was just as real as Socrates, Plato, or Caesar. The conviction became a certainty. I knew that Jesus Christ had indeed lived because of the facts connected with the period of his life and the time in which he lived. And so he asked himself this candid question. If he was a real person, if Jesus Christ was a real person, was he not then also the Son of God and the Savior of the world? Gradually, Wallace realized that since Jesus was a real person, he probably was all that he claimed to be. And so Wallace confesses, quote, "I fell on my knees to pray for the first time in my life, and I asked God to reveal himself to me," which, by the way, had already been happening, but I digress. Back to the quote. And he said, "I prayed, forgive my sins, and help me to become a follower of Jesus Christ." And he said, "Towards morning, the light broke into my soul. I went into my bedroom. I awakened my wife and told her that I had received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior." I'm telling you, friends, you don't want to go there. Well, you do want to go there, but for those that are thinking they can go there. "Oh, Lou," she said, "I have been praying for you ever since you told me the purpose of this book, that you would find the real Jesus as you sought to write about and disprove him." Here is what Lou Wallace said. If he was a real person, was he then not also the Son of God and the Savior of the world? The Savior of the world. Good question. Actually, there may well be no more important question than this one. Every generation has a gateway question. A question that expresses the deepest longing of that generation's heart and is the way into that generation's heart. And for Generation X, which is a term typically used to describe the generation of Americans born between 1965 and 1980. Okay, and I was born in 1969, all right? And this generational question is, what is real? Reality. No, I don't. I'm schooled in this. It's been several years since I studied it intentionally and intently, but I did have several semesters of philosophy where we considered the works of Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. Okay, I'm familiar with Plato's ideal plane and his concept of realism. I am not particularly interested this morning in discussing forms and shadows or debating perceptions and whether we're actually looking at life as through a mirror and what we see are actually shadows of the real things, okay? In that sense, I'm familiar with that dynamic, and I'm familiar with the work of some of the ancient philosophers, and if that's some place you want to go, go for it. I mean, with Google and access that we have to information on computers today, you're certainly welcome to pursue that if you would like. But I'm not really going to go there today. I'm aware of that plateau, but I'm not going there. Rather, I would choose to ask this question. What is meant by those in Generation X when they refer to what is real? Like, I don't think it's a platonic pursuit, if I'm honest with you, okay? Rather, I think what's happening is that what they are pursuing is authenticity. I think it's a question of authenticity. My business card, my personal business card literally has on it real people, real faith, real choices. I smiled because I didn't realize I was much the byproduct of my generation as apparently I am, right? And what's behind that when you say a phrase like real people, real faith, real choices? I submit to you it's a question of authenticity. Okay, now what is authenticity? Authenticity is something that conforms to an original so as to reproduce essential features. Now this gets interesting in and of itself. Because when you start to talk about what is real and what is reality, if something is authentic, it conforms to the original. Being the fact I'm a preacher, we're all gathered in church today, I bet you know what I'm going to do with that, don't you? To those of us who are called to be disciples of Jesus Christ, those who conform to the original, so as to reproduce in their lives essential features. What if the Bible is true? Last week's question, what is true? We looked at the Word of God and we said not only is God true, God's Word is true. But it goes beyond that, doesn't it? We went to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9, where it asked these questions. It's speaking. Actually, the prophet Isaiah was speaking to his generation. He said, you're always hearing, but never understanding. You're seeing, but never perceiving. Do you know what that means? It means you could be confronted with the truth and not understand it, not embrace it, not receive it, and certainly never apply it. Miss Vicky was teaching this morning. We got some excellent discipleship hour teachers, Sunday school teachers. Blaine typically downstairs, Vicky upstairs. Ken helps and teaches sometimes. Chris, Pastor Chris with the young adults and teachers down through for the younger ages as well. Got excellent teachers. We have great discussions. And Vicky was talking about those in the scripture, actually the majority of them, Apollos and Paul being rare exceptions, were uneducated men and women. In fact, Jesus himself, when he would teach, many times those gathered would say, the Bible repeats in multiple places, they were amazed at what he was teaching because they're like, he's an uneducated man. At one point, the New Testament professors at Harvard University were agnostics. They were atheists. They knew the Bible, but they didn't believe that the Bible was true. So it's one thing for us to confess what Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. But to be authentic means to embrace that in such a way that we seek to apply it in our own minds, in our own hearts. And that's actually part of the role of the Holy Spirit in our lives and not made possible apart from that. But we, therefore, are to live lives which basically are reproductions or replica of the life of Christ. To be an authentic reproduction. To be authentic is to be genuine. In other words, it's the question of the real deal. Now, you know, one of the primary accusations leveled at people of faith is this. They're hypocrites. They're hypocrites. In other words, they're not genuine. They're not authentic. They're not real. By the way, how many of you don't have to raise your hands. Don't raise your hands. In the effort, in the unfolding, lifelong effort of trying to be like Christ, have come to realize that the Christian ethic, the ideal laid out by Christ himself, may be, I hate to use this word, but the most impossible, you know, way to live that's ever been known. I mean, I would like to say this not as an excuse and not to simply make you feel better, but I would like, I think to be intellectually honest, we have to at least allow for the fact that if you are making the effort to be an authentic follower of Jesus Christ, and by authentic, to be an accurate reproduction of the essential features of the original, how can there be any higher calling in life? Like, part of the reason that maybe these people perceive Christians are failing at the pursuit of being authentic reproductions is because we're trying to reach for the highest plane that anyone who has ever lived has ever reached to. You think it was bad being a Jew? Jesus would come along and say things in the Sermon on the Mount like, you have heard it said, to love your neighbor, right? He said, I say this, pray for those who persecute you. Do good to those who wrongfully accuse you. Love your enemies. He said, you've been told not to commit murder. He said, I tell you that if you've harbored anger in your heart, you've already murdered them inside. And it's like, what? I mean, whoa. So don't get so down on yourself. Twofold. Number one, you can't possibly attain who Jesus Christ is. You ain't going to do it. But you know what? God knew that. So what did he do? Not only did he take the penalty for sin and death and raise to set us free to walk in liberty, he offers us the Holy Spirit to fill us and to accomplish from within what we can't do from without. Somebody say amen. Amen. All right? So apart from this, you're not going to be genuine. You're not going to accomplish it in your own strength, okay? Now, moving on, let's begin with this. Few people question Jesus' authenticity. Like, they believe Jesus is the real deal, okay? And yet, listen, the evidence of his life still did not convince most of the people he ministered to. You're like, what? Here, I'll show you. John chapter 10, beginning in verse 22. Look at this. It was the time for the festival of dedication in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus himself was in the temple courts. You came to hear me today? Imagine if Jesus were up here teaching. That's what they had. Jesus was in the temple. He was walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were gathered around him were saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Tell us who you are." Jesus answered, I did tell you, but you did not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish, for no one will snatch them out of my hand. We sang that this morning. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. Somebody say amen there. Jesus says, I and the Father are one. That's the type of claim. Well, that comes later in the passage, but would get him in trouble. But anyway. Again, his Jewish opponents picked up stones to stone him, but Jesus said to them, I have shown you many good works from the Father. From which of these do you stone me? We are not stoning you for any good work, they replied, but for blasphemy, because you, a mere man, claim to be God. And Jesus answered them, Is it not written in your law, I have said you are gods? If he called them gods to whom the word of God came and scripture cannot be set aside, what about the one whom the Father set apart as his very own and sent him into the world? Then why do you accuse me of blasphemy because I said I am God's son? Do not believe me unless I do the works of my Father. What's that the question of? Authenticity. He said, do I look like my Father or not? But if I do, even though you do not believe me, believe the works. Believe the works that I do, that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. Jesus, in essence, is saying, why is this even a question? You confess that I'm doing my Father's work. Look at the evidence. The miracles I perform speak to my identity. I am, by that phrase is loaded in and of itself, I am the Son of God. And so it is that Lew Wallace, seeking to discredit Christ, came to say, if he was a real person, was he not then also the Son of God and the Savior of the world? And yes, history proves he was indeed a real person. I think then the question, the follow-up question becomes this, are his claims real as well? Are his claims about himself real? And that's today's question, what is real? The Bible clearly espouses a belief in this concept of reality and fiction. What is real versus what is false. And the Bible says we can know the difference. Did you know that? The Bible says we can literally know the difference. In the Proverbs, it states the righteous hate what is false. And in the book of Ephesians, it says we are to put off falsehood. Okay, we are to put off falsehood. In other words, be real. This has applications in spirituality, philosophy, and daily life. The Bible says some things simply are. They are true and they are real. And your denial of them does not cause them to cease to exist. And some things are not. They are false. They are not real. And that this absolute goes beyond personal opinion or knowledge. Spiritually speaking, the idea of truth implies that not all religious ideas can be true simultaneously. Now, I need you to pay attention. Those watching online, okay, you stay with me. You came here today, you might as well get the most out of it, right? Now, listen to me. Universalism. Been common for a couple decades now, okay? I'm getting old. I'm getting a little longer in the tooth. I've been doing this a while. I'm closing in on 30 years of ministry. And all the way back when I was ordained, we were talking about this. At the time in the Crystal Cathedral, Reverend Robert Schuller, y'all remember the Crystal Cathedral? And Reverend Robert Schuller, they had had some other faith leaders there at their church, and he had made this comment, "We call him Jesus. You call him Muhammad, you call him Buddha," right? And it was kind of like the claims basically of universalism, all roads lead to God. And in the modern era, it actually, they claim, doesn't matter so much what you believe. The hallmark of your belief is its sincerity. Let me help you to understand something in case you're getting a little confused. Or even if you're touching in and going back out again and you don't stick around for all four generational questions, let me help you understand something, okay? Those who say the hallmark of what is right and true is the sincerity of your belief, they're speaking to this issue of authenticity, and they're speaking to this concept of what is real. But if you're authentic, but it's based on something that's not true, you're authentically false. You're still deceived. Like, these generational questions necessarily are woven into one common fabric that is given to us from God Almighty himself, who is truth. Jesus said, "I am the way. I am the truth. I myself am." God's word is truth, okay? And so this idea, we live in a day where they say it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you believe it sincerely enough. Friends, there are a lot of people who are sincerely deceived. Are you listening to me? What I'm saying is this. Jesus said, "He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except by him." That statement in and of itself necessarily means that claims contradictory to his cannot be true. Or his statement is not true. One or the other. This exclusivity is further, boy, I got that word right, Ken. Put that down in my book. That was not an easy one for this guy to say, but is further supported by these passages. Look, John chapter 3, y'all know 16, here's 18. "Whoever believes in him, being Jesus, is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in Christ," what does it say? "Stands condemned already." Can you imagine those people who think that they're going to be okay because they basically lived by whatever standard, what they define to be a good life? Most often espoused by, "I didn't kill anybody." Well, that one goes out the window quick if you read the Sermon on the Mount, because Jesus said if you had anger in your heart, you killed them in your heart. And it's like, oh, man. What did I tell you earlier? It's easy to point fingers and say, "You guys are hypocrites. You're not just like Jesus." Do you know what's involved to be like Jesus? I've been in that process my whole life, and I still have a long way to go. How about you? That doesn't mean you abandon the task, okay? But anyway, I digress. They stand condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. John 3:36, later in the same chapter, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them." Wow. Go ahead. I'll meet some of you afterwards if you'd like. You can explain to me how Muhammad or Buddha or anyone else is going to help you with that one. I mean, these claims are exclusive, okay? They clearly state that those who reject Christ cannot hope for salvation. The biblical claim is there's no reality in the idea of salvation apart from Jesus Christ. Now, according to the scriptures, moral truth exists, and anything opposed to it is sin. Now, I got a whole bunch of scriptures, but I'm just going to give you one. James 4. "If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, then for them it's what? It's sin." Okay? Any of y'all ever struggled with that? Steve, don't slander. Steve, don't gossip. Steve, don't harbor you know, bitterness in your heart. Steve, how long do we want this list to go, right? Hence the accusations, you're not authentic, you're not real. A few years back, I was having so many conversations with Christians and people in this church, but not just people in this church. People are just like, Pastor, I'm not even sure I am a believer. Why would you say that? Well, the other day I had this terrible thought in my mind, or I said something that as soon as it came out of my mouth, I thought to myself, how can someone who loves Jesus Christ say something like that? Or I had this, you know, and one thing after another, and I'm just kind of like, oh, so you haven't attained Christian perfection yet, right? I mean, the Bible says you got to die to self how often? How often? So it don't matter if you did it yesterday, you got to do it again today. There are thoughts that come into your mind that you have to take captive. Ken and I and Julie and Chris, we were having a conversation, and I'm so glad for each of them and for so many of you. There are so many in this body of faith who are gifted or perceptive in ways that I am not, and that way we can complement one another, right? But in this realm of being experiencing liberty, being set free, and even things that bind us in the spirit realm, one of the things we have to understand is in most areas where we struggle, and most of us struggle in one or two or three specific areas. Like, I've used these examples in the past, and I'm off task, so I need to get off this rabbit trail quick, but I just feel like I'm supposed to be here. Satan knows about you what you have revealed. God knows your thoughts before the words are on your lips, but Satan isn't God. He's a created order of beings. Satan is a fallen angel, okay? So Satan doesn't know your thoughts. He knows what you reveal about yourself, but you've exposed yourself. Some of you are like, I did. You have exposed yourself. Satan is aware of where you are weak. He knows what buttons to push to get to you, and so this is what he does. He just goes, boop, and then you fall into it, and then he goes, boop. And you fall into it again, and he goes, boop. The whole time he's just laughing. He's like, this fool don't even realize how easy it is. So let me give you an example. I don't struggle with gambling. Okay, I don't struggle with gamble. I didn't bet on the horse race yesterday. I don't know who won. I'm not laying down bets or whatever. I don't struggle with homosexuality. And that's not to belittle anyone who does struggle with gambling, who does struggle with homosexuality, okay? The reason I say that is I can overcome those things in my own strength. That doesn't sound very scriptural or biblical, does it? Y'all out there going, wow, he's talking about doing things in his own strength. Oh, come on, we all do it more than we want to admit, right? But my point is this. Satan isn't going to try to tempt me there. He isn't going to try to trip me up there because Satan knows I'm not vulnerable there. He's not, it's something that doesn't tempt me, something that I'm not interested in, right? Satan isn't going to waste his time. So Satan, they're like, okay, Pastor, you told us a couple areas you're not vulnerable. Tell us some of your vulnerabilities, you witch. You better know your own, though. Because that's what Satan's going to target with you, if you haven't figured that out. He waited, as you know, till Jesus was hungry and had fasted for 40 days till he tempted him with what? Food. If you're the Son of God, take that stone and speak to it and turn it into bread, right? Turn it into bread. Now, if Jesus was well fed, would that hold any strength of conviction for him whatsoever? No, you hear what I'm saying? So I had these people that were like, well, I can't possibly be a Christian. Why? Because you're still in process of working out your salvation? Sure you can. But one of the realities about being set free is that many times you have to take that thought captive when you first begin to engage the battle minute by minute. It's not even day by day. It's minute by minute. Then it becomes hour by hour. Then maybe it becomes day by day until the point that you can go extended periods where that no longer has control or sway or influence in your life. That's the way it works, but we want God to just take it away. He does sometimes, just like he instantaneously, miraculously heals in the physical realm sometimes. But sometimes you engage the battle for a lifetime. My point is this, don't become disengaged over temporary failures or temporary disappointments. You are not perfect, but God knew that. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Back on task. Here we go. Okay, here's things I need you to understand. One of the longest-running philosophical debates is over the difference between what is abstract and what is concrete. Concrete concepts are things like length, right? The number four. However, there are other things that don't have meaningful connections to concrete things. Biblically speaking, we might be talking about concepts such as justice, good, sin, whatever. This is what I'm trying to help you to understand. You cannot fill a jar with good in the same way that you can fill a jar with sand. But that does not mean that good is not true or real in a meaningful way. When something lacks a concrete unit of measure, how do you measure sin? How do you measure good, right? So I need you to understand, it's one thing to say, how do I hard boil an egg? And another thing altogether to ask, how do I know if I'm in love? Ooh. How do I hard boil an egg versus how do I know if I'm in love? Now, which do you think ultimately is more important? But which is easier to qualify, right? I can walk you through the steps of how to hard boil an egg. The question of whether or not you're in love, ooh, much more important question, but much more involved. So with that idea in mind, we can also distinguish between abstractions that exist and those that technically do not. You're like, what? Well, sin is real in the sense that good is real. But neither of them is concrete. That is, there's no physical particle or energy that God created as a unit of good or as a unit of sin. However, they are both real. The difference is, listen, that sin in and of itself is defined only in terms of the absence of goodness. Some of you are struggling, so I'll bring this around. In other words, sin is only real in the sense that it's connected to what is good, and we come to understand the lack of what is good. It might be argued, therefore, that the absence of God, who is the source of everything good, is the ultimate expression of sin. In other words, God can create good as an ideal, and sin can exist where there is the lack of goodness. Now, for those of you that are struggling with this, and as convoluted as it sounds, let me bring this back to the realm of physics and the physical realm. Darkness is an abstraction, but it corresponds to something real. Darkness is the absence of light, which, depending on the sense in which we are using it, is a real physical thing made up of photons. Light is measurable. Darkness is the complete absence of light. Cold is an abstraction because it corresponds to the absence of heat. So some of you are going, yeah, you should have let that heat inside, the ladies that are in the sweaters here this morning as we gather. But understand this, heat is a real thing. Also measurable. Cold is the absence, therefore, of heat. Neither darkness nor coldness exist in and of themselves. They are both defined entirely as the lack of something else. Are you with me? So, disciples of Christ, Christians, either bear fruit in keeping with their connectedness to God through Jesus Christ, or they don't. They are real and authentic, or they are false. And here's the question. Which are you? Which are you? Jesus said that you would be known by your fruit and that apart from him you could do nothing. In fact, he says you have to remain connected to him. You have to remain in him or you'll wither and die. You know this passage. Here it is. In which one do I have here, fellas? John 15. I am the vine, Jesus said, and my Father, the gardener, he cuts off every branch that bears no fruit. I think that should get your attention. How you doing in the fruit-bearing area, folks? But even if you are bearing fruit, he's going to prune those so you'll be even more fruitful. Wow. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For no branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Very specific. I am the vine, Jesus says. You're the branches. And if you remain in me, you'll bear much fruit, but apart from me, you'll do nothing. And if you do not remain, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned up. But if you remain in me and my words, that's truth, remain in you, ask what you wish and it'll be done. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. That fruit shows the authenticity of our life. You were created to glorify God and are known by the fruit of your life. Luke 6, no good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. Each tree is recognized by its fruit. People do not pick figs from thorn bushes or grapes from briars. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. And I ask you, which are you? King James here would say, for out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. That's what scares us sometimes when we hear the things that come out of our mouths. Because we go, oh, I didn't mean that. And then we go, oh, no, my filters didn't catch it, and I didn't take the thought captive, and I didn't bring that under the lordship of Christ quickly enough. So I blurted out something harmful and hurtful and hateful because I didn't catch it inside. But what harms us or hurts us the most is understanding that that was in our hearts and that we need God to touch that part of our hearts. And aren't you glad that we have a God who doesn't abandon us to the task of seeking to become more like him? How many of y'all want to be more like him? How many of y'all just want to set aside all the falsity and false pursuits and all this other stuff in the pursuit of being like Jesus? Now, this is what I need you to understand. You need to see this, okay? Music team, just so you know, we're not going to have time for the closing song. I need to finish this truth out. It's too important to lay aside. So just rest easy and soak this in, okay? A real Christian will show you his faith by how he lives. This is what I need you to see. You want to know what a real Christian is? You want to know what an authentic Christian is? This isn't Pastor Steve. This is biblical definitions, okay? There's the scripture. I can email this to people if y'all want it, okay? The Bible defines a true or authentic or real Christian as one who has personally received Jesus Christ as their Savior. Personally. Okay? One who trusts in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of their sins. Not my sins. You know, I'm grateful. I have taken that step. I have trusted Christ. His forgiveness is real for me, but it's real for you too. Hence, we say there's no grandchildren in heaven. The grandparents always cringe at that because they think, you mean my grandchild ain't going to heaven? No, there's children in heaven. You don't get to go. My kids won't be there because I'm there. They have to choose for themselves, okay? Those who have received the Holy Spirit and have the Holy Spirit residing within them and whose life evinces, and some of you go say, what? Let me finish. Change consistent with faith in Jesus. Evinces is one of those grammatically correct words that means brings to fruition or demonstrates the evidence of and or the realization of a life that is consistent with a faith in Jesus Christ. You know what that last one means? You're real. You're authentic. People look at you and instead of seeing you, they see Jesus. Whoa, that isn't easy. And it isn't going to happen by mistake. You're not going to stumble into that, okay? The Spirit has to lead you into that, and then you have to be sensitive and walk in it. And according to Christianity, absolute reality is truth. Truth is what actually exists, which corresponds by definition to what is real. And the most important aspects of truth are given to us by God. Reality can be known. It can be applied to every aspect of our lives, but we can't do it by ourselves. In fact, the Apostle Paul contends fullness of life is found in Christ alone. All right, last scripture. So just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him. Rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human traditions and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Jesus Christ. By the way, that's also why it's Get your spiritual antenna up when someone tells you, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. It could be something you have to be attentive to because of that verse we just read. There's people who want to be spiritual but deny Jesus Christ. That's a problem. Can't develop that right now, but just a little tidbit for you. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and every authority. In him you were circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ. That's all falsehood. And having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were raised through your faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead, right? When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all of our sins. And having canceled are the charge of our legal indebtedness to God, which stood against us and condemned us, he took it away, nailing it to the cross of Jesus Christ. And having disarmed the powers and authorities of this world, he made a public spectacle out of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to religious festival, new moon celebrations, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow. Here's Plato. Not really, but kind of. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, I love this. The reality is found in Jesus Christ. The reality is found in Jesus Christ. Now, my dear wife, I love her dearly. She's so good, so kind to me, so patient. Has got the kids here. Before you go, very brief, we just have a couple awards to give them, okay? But I need to finish this. Give me one more minute. Back in 1830, George Wilson was convicted of robbing the U.S. mail and was sentenced to be hanged. President Andrew Jackson issued a pardon for Wilson, but he refused to accept it. The matter went to Chief Justice Marshall, who concluded that Wilson would have to be executed. Quote, a pardon is a slip of paper, wrote Marshall, the value of which is determined by the acceptance of the person to be pardoned. If it is refused, it is no pardon at all. George Wilson must therefore be hanged. End quote. For some, the pardon comes too late. For others, the pardon is not accepted. Christ died once for all. Reality is found in Christ, but friends, you know what? We have to accept it, and we have to walk in it. I found this song in our hymnals. It's number 440. I know most of you can't sit here and read that before this ends. I've never sung the song before in my life. I didn't hand it to my worship team because I'm like, I don't even know it. I'm not going to ask them to do it. But the words were so powerful and effective for today, and we did kind of learn it. We were going to sing it, but for time's sake, I'm going to let that go today. Maybe we'll reintroduce that to you. Maybe I'll send the words out in an email or something. If you're not on our email list and would like to be, just write your email down and hand it to me before you leave today, okay? Or set it on my desk or whatever, and I'll add you to that list if you'd like to be on there. I still owe y'all the stuff on William Carey that I didn't send out yet from Wednesday night. If you don't come Wednesday, you probably don't know what I'm talking about. But here's my broader point, okay? Here's my broader point. It's one thing for Christ to offer up to you a pardon. So every truth that's in this passage right here is made available to you. If you don't receive it, guess what? If you don't confess Jesus Christ, guess what? John 3 says you're still condemned in your sin. You're still condemned in your sin, friends. It's made possible, but you have to receive it, accept it, and apply it. And if you do that, then it's real. It's real. What good is that? Well, I'm glad you asked. Next week's question, what is good? What is good, okay, as we move on to our next generation. Dear, are you out there with some little ones? Can you hear my voice? I assume you can. Those watching online, we're going to let you go. Do a little in-house stuff today. God be with you. Hey, this gift This pardon through Jesus Christ for the penalty of your sins is for you. All you have to do is receive it by faith. I hope you'll make that choice. You have questions, reach out to us, okay? We'd love to help you with that. God be with you.